Hello everyone. The topic for presentation is multilocular radiolucencies of the jaws. Multilocular radiolucencies is a pattern which is frequently used terminology to describe the radiographic image. So you can have a multilocular radiolucency and a unilocular radiolucency. Unilocular radiolucency means you have a radiolucent, a single radiolucent area. Multilocular radiolucency means you have a multiple radiolucent areas which are separated by a thin septa. This is multilocular radiolucency. So this is the specimen with multilocular radiolucencies. You have multiple compartments which are separated by a septa, multiple septa. This is the specimen. If you take this into a radiographic image, it appears like this. A radiolucence is multiple radiolucent compartments which are separated by the septa. These radiolucencies, either they vary in size, either they can be small or large in size. So they are usually, sometimes these multilocular radiolucencies are formed by multiple adjacent small areas which join together to form multiple areas. Now sometimes a large lesion with destruction of the bone will be taking place. There will be small amount of remnant of the bone will be left out as a septa. That appears as multilocular radiolucency. There can be true multilocular radiolucency and pseudo multilocular radiolucency. What is pseudo multilocular radiolucency means? Actually, it is a unilocular radiolucency that have perforated the cortical plate in one or more areas, because the radiographic image is a two-dimensional image of a three-dimensional organ or substance. So if you see this, depending on the destruction of the bone at multiple areas, it is not even, the destruction of the bone sometimes is not even in all the areas. It will be more in one area and less in another area. So if the destruction is more, it appears more radiolucent compared to the less destructed area. So this is it appears here as more radiolucent, here it is appearing as less radiolucent. So it is appearing like a multilocular radiolucency, but it is a unilocular radiolucency. Depending on the destruction of the bone at that particular area, it is appearing like multilocular. So this is called pseudo-multilocular radiolucency. What is pseudo-unilocular radiolucency means? Actually, it is a multilocular radiolucency, but the septa will be very thin and indistinct in the image. They are not seen clearly. The septa are not seen clearly because either they are very thin or the density of that septa is very less. So that's why they doesn't appear prominent in the radiographic image. They appear like unilocular. That time they are called pseudo-unilocular radiolucencies. Now coming to the pattern of multilocular radiolucencies, there are three patterns. Soap bubble pattern, honeycomb, tennis racket pattern. So when you say it is a soap bubble pattern means the multiple locules are there. So these multiple locules, usually they vary in size. When they vary in size, that means in a single lesion, if the size of the locules in some areas it is small, some areas it is big. And also these locules should be circular. So that time it is called, it is soap bubble appearance. See here, it is a small circle. Here it is a large circle, radiolucent area. So it is a soap bubble appearance. Here it is honeycomb pattern. So honeycomb pattern means the radiolucencies, the compartments are usually uniform is in size, not exact but almost uniform in size. It is called honeycomb pattern. Coming to tennis racket pattern, here also you will have multiple radiolucent areas separated by the septa, but here at one or two or three areas the septa are usually straight. They are straight. Here if you see in soap bubble and honeycomb, the septa are curved. But here in tennis racket, there will be at least one septa that is straight. So that time it is called tennis racket pattern. So why you need to know these patterns means sometimes the diseases, the lesions are described or diagnosed with the help of patterns. That's why it is, the patterns are very important. And coming to the anatomical structures that mimic multilocular radiolucencies in the jaws are maxillary sinus and bone marrow spaces. Maxillary sinus will have a multiple compartments. So which mimic like multilocular radiolucencies. So if you suspect multilocular radiolucencies, first you have to exclude whether it is an anatomical structure or it is a pathological lesion. So first you, and maxillary sinus means it is seen in the maxilla and also in the posterior aspect, in the premolar and molar region, not in the anterior region. And you have to exclude with multilocular radiolucency by the adjacent structures also, with the location and also with the adjacent structures. Adjacent structures means zygoma or maxillary tuberosity, etc. And also the absence of the symptoms. That means you have to see if you are suspecting any multilocular radiolucencies. See whether there is any odontogenic or non-odontogenic infection is there, or any lesion or tumor is present or not. If it is there, any symptoms related to that particular disease is there or not, you have to see to exclude this with maxillary sinus and multilocular radiolucency. Coming to bone marrow spaces, they and trabecular pattern. This bone marrow spaces and trabecular pattern, especially in the mandible, appears like multilocular radiolucencies. So that you have to exclude by comparing that area with the adjacent area. Suppose you are suspecting any multilocular radiolucencies at the apex of some particular tooth. So you have to compare that with the adjacent areas or to the opposite part of that particular area and exclude the multilocular radiolucencies. This is how you have to exclude the multilocular radiolucencies with the anatomical structures which mimic multilocular radiolucencies. Now coming to the lesions, the most common multilocular radiolucencies are ameloblastoma, odontogenic keratocyst, central giant cell granuloma, aneurysmal bone cyst, odontogenic myxoma, giant cell lesion of hyperparathyroidism, cherubism, botryoid odontogenic cyst, metastatic tumors of the jaws, vascular malformations, central hemangioma. This is slightly difficult to remember, so you have to differentiate, you have classify this, have to classify this according to the cyst tumors like that. So under cyst you can tell odontogenic keratosis, basal cell nevus syndrome is nothing but when you see multiple odontogenic cysts along with other conditions, it is basal cell nevus syndrome. Aneurysmal bone cyst, botryoid odontogenic cyst comes under the cyst with multilocular radiolucencies. Under tumors, ameloblastoma, odontogenic myxoma, central hemangioma of bone. These are benign tumors. The metastatic tumors of the jaws are malignancies. And you can also see bone diseases which are associated with the jaws are cherubism, central giant cell granuloma. And also there are some jaw lesions with systemic diseases with multilocular radiolucencies, that is giant cell lesion of hyperparathyroidism. So if you remember according to this, like cyst tumors and like this, you can remember all the lesions. Now coming to each one, the most common one is actually ameloblastoma, but I will be taking like according to the classification. So first one is odontogenic keratocyst. So odontogenic keratocyst is a non-inflammatory odontogenic cyst that arises from the dental lamina. The clinical features are usually this odontogenic keratocyst is usually seen in the younger age people, that is in 20 to 30 years of age group people, and males are most commonly affected compared to the females. And the mandible, many multilocular radiolucencies, the mandible is most commonly affected. If the maxilla is affected, you have to be very careful, because as the lesion grows in the maxilla, usually it invades into the maxillary sinus or into the floor of the nasal cavity. So you have to be very careful, and usually the maxillary lesions with multilocular radiolucencies are very rare. So mandible is the most common site for many multilocular radiolucencies. And coming to odontogenic keratosis, the mandible is most frequently involved, and especially the body of the mandible and also the ramus, that is the ascending ramus, are the most common sites. And coming to the presentation, the clinical presentation, usually if you see the patient with odontogenic keratosis, the facial asymmetry is not much, because the extensive enlargement of the cortical bone is not present in this odontogenic keratosis. This is the main important feature for this lesion, odontogenic keratosis. It will extend in the anterior posterior direction, that is within the bone in the anterior posterior direction, not in the buccolingual direction. So cortical expansion is very less. So you will see only a mild swelling, and also the pain is not much in these patients unless the lesion is secondarily infected. So usually it is free of symptoms, and if pain is also there, it is because of the secondary infection. And as the lesion grows, it displaces the teeth. The root resorption is not much, and the cortical expansion is also not much. And it will displace the inferior alveolar canal apically. That means it displaces the inferior alveolar canal to lower side. Sometimes there will be paresthesia of the lower lip if the inferior alveolar nerve is affected, because you cannot see the expansion, but if you see radiologically, there will be more amount of destruction. So sometimes you will have, without any expansion, there will be pathological fracture of the jaw bones. And if you aspirate, you can have thick yellow cheesy material, because this cyst contains keratin as the material inside the cavity. This keratin is derived from the epithelium. It will derive from the epithelium. So when you aspirate the cavity, you can get a thick yellow cheesy material. Coming to the radiological features, any lesion, if you are describing radiologically, four things you have to remember. First thing is the location of the lesion, radiological lesion, and how is the periphery, what is the shape of the lesion, and how is the internal structure, and how it affects to the surrounding structures, that is affects on the surrounding structure. Now coming to odontogenic keratosis, as I told, the location, the most common location is in the mandible posterior region, that is the body of the mandible and the ramus. The periphery is usually, it is round and has got well defined sclerotic margins. Because it is a slow growing lesion, you can see a sclerotic margins clearly. And there will be scalloped margins. They are round but scalloped. The margins are scalloped. That means it tells that there is an unequal growth activity that is taking place at different parts of the cyst. So the cyst, the growth, that is the destruction, is not equal at all the areas. It is unequal. So that's why you can see a scalloped margins. Coming to the internal structures, it can be, if the cyst is very small, it is unilocular. If it is a large cyst, it is multilocular. And internal structure, it is not completely radiolucent because it is filled with keratin, as I told you, which is derived from the epithelial lining. So it appears cloudy. Some density you can see in the radiograph. It is not completely radiolucent. So how this expansion affects to the surrounding structures means it displaces the teeth. The root resorption is very rare, and I told you it expands the anterior posterior direction, that is along the internal aspect of the jaw. There is no expansion, very minimal expansion in the buccolingual direction. And the displacement of the inferior alveolar canal in the direction. So here if you see, you can see a radiolucency, multiple, you can see a septa here, multiple multilocular radiolucency, which is extending from body of the mandible into almost the whole ramus is involved. You can see the displacement of the third molar apically, inferiorly, and you can see the pathological fracture also here. So a big multilocular radiolucencies here. So here there is displacement of the teeth, you can see, and there is no destruction or resorption of the roots. Here also if you see, there is displacement of the inferior alveolar canal downwards. And here this is the odontogenic keratocyst cropped section of panoramic radiograph. Here you see, for the same one, you can see the occlusal radiograph. See, the lesion is very large, but if you take the occlusal radiograph, the cortical expansion in the buccolingual direction is very minimal. This is the most important clinical feature for the diagnosis of odontogenic keratosis, because the lesion will be more very large, but the expansion of the bone is not much, and the symmetry of the face is, asymmetry is very minimal. So because of this, you can also have the pathological fracture of the jaw bones. Coming to the management, if you suspect any odontogenic keratosis in a periapical radiograph or any localized area, you have to take a panoramic radiograph to see any multiple odontogenic keratosis that are present, because multiple odontogenic keratosis are seen in the basal cell nevus syndrome. So you have to take a panoramic radiograph if you see any OKC in a localized area. And the treatment is the surgical treatment, that is resection, curettage if the lesion is large, marsupialization, and complete, you have to remember that complete removal of the wall should be there, because the recurrence rate is very high, because there will be bud-like projections from the basal epithelium to the adjacent connective tissue will be there, like small satellite microcysts, islands of epithelium will be present in the walls. So if you remove the wall incompletely without adding the normal adjacent bone, the recurrence will be more because of this satellite microcysts or finger-like projections. So the complete removal with a sufficient amount of normal bone should be there. And the periodic follow-up radiographs and clinical examination should be there to see if there is any recurrence rate is there or not. So this recurrence usually develops within first 5 years. So for the first 5 years, if the recurrence is not there, you can stop checking the periodic post clinical, but it's important to check for 5 more years. Basal cell nevus syndrome, as I told you, the basal cell nevus syndrome is the presence of multiple odontogenic keratosis. So along with multiple, the other name for basal cell nevus syndrome is Gorlin-Gall syndrome. And along with multiple odontogenic keratosis, you can you also have multiple nevoid basal cell carcinomas of skin and skeletal, central nervous system, ocular abnormalities are present in this syndrome. So odontogenic keratosis, usually it is seen in 20 to 30 years of age, but here in basal cell nevus syndrome there will be multiple odontogenic keratosis but are seen at the age of 5 years only, and also before 30 years only they develop. But if you see any they are seen below 30 years, and also the recurrence rate is very high compared to a solitary odontogenic keratosis. So the treatment should be a very wide in the, if you see basal cell nevus syndrome, the treatment same, the resection, curettage, marsupialization, because the recurrence rate is very high compared to the solitary one, the follow-up is must. Coming to aneurysmal bone cyst, its aneurysmal bone cyst is a reactive lesion of the bone. It is not a true cyst because it does not have a true epithelium. It is a pseudocyst. It usually affects the long bones and the vertebra, and very less number of cases are seen with the head and neck region, and usually seen in the age group of 20 years and below, and posterior mandible is the most common site, and women has got slightly predilection for this disease. Here you see this is an aneurysmal bone cyst. See here, it's a cortical expansion, is that is the growth is very aggressive in this lesion. So the etiology is mostly it's because of the trauma. So if you ask the history, the patient tells you that he had some trauma. So the etiology is a trauma. Main symptoms are usually patient will have very dull pain. Even though lesion is very big, they will have very dull pain. The lesion is very rapid in growth. And if you resect the jaw and if you cut the specimen, you can see, that is the macroscopic examination, you can see sponge-like appearance. That means the sponge filled with blood. you can see. That means because it is a traumatic origin, aneurysmal bone cyst. So you can see a sponge-like appearance filled with blood separated by a fibrous thin septa. Coming to the radiological features, the mandible molar ramus region again is the most common site, well defined and circular margins, and effects on the surrounding structures means because it is an extreme expansion you see in this lesion, that is blown out appearance. You have seen this in the clinical picture of a lady. The mandible, the whole mandible is blown out. So it is very aggressive in expansion. So blown out appearance is seen, and there will be displacement of the will be there. Coming to the internal structure, it is again multilocular radiolucency, and the septa are usually thin because it expands very fast. The destruction of the bone also is more. So the septa are usually ill-defined. And sometimes you see if the lesion is very large, you can see a right angle positioned septa to the outer border, cortical border. The treatment is again the surgical excision, curettage, and also you can do sclerotherapy, embolization, radiotherapy and cryosurgery for aneurysmal bone cyst as treatment. Coming to botryoid odontogenic cyst, it is a variant of lateral periodontal cyst. Lateral periodontal cyst is a unilocular radiolucency. The multilocular variant of this lateral periodontal cyst is the botryoid odontogenic cyst. So botryoid means grape-like appearance. So it appears like a bunch of grapes at the lateral border, lateral aspect of the root. It's usually seen in elderly people like 60 to 70 year age group. The most common location, the most common area that is affected are the mandibular, canine and first premolar region. Usually they are less than 1 centimeter in diameter and are usually asymptomatic in nature. The treatment is conservative enucleation. The recurrence rate is very high, so the periodic follow-up is must. So this is about different patterns of multilocular radiolucencies, and the lesions we have discussed is odontogenic keratocyst, basal cell nevus, and aneurysmal bone cyst, botryoid odontogenic cyst. Thank you.